Hello and welcome back to Wizard Kid. Last time we covered,
Hell if I remember.
Yeah, it's been a bit of a long time.
It hasn't been that bad.
What was before that? Just the writing on the wall, right. So yeah, basically the aftermath of, the first petrification. Today, Wizard Kid is finally gonna cast his first fucking spell.
Yeah.
Because it's the Dueling Club.
It took a long time, but we finally got there.
We're only doing one today.
Yep.
But yeah, so if you're okay to just start off, unless you want to do your like counters and stuff.
There's very little to do. There's no localization changes that I could find other than like a single sentence adding the word the.
Excellent.
We have a heel turn. When Harry's in the library, he turned on his heel and stormed out of the library, earning himself a reproving glare from Madam Pince. I don't know what the fuck reproving means. I'm gonna count this one as Sassy Harry, though I don't know if it could have been genuine. When Lockhart is trying to teach him how to, like, block Malfoy's spell, he does like a complicated little thing and drops his wand, and Harry's like, can you show me that thing again? He's like, just do what I did again. He's like, what, drop my wand?
I think that was Harry being sarcastic.
Yeah, so I'm counting that as Sassy Harry. Yeah. That's pretty much all we got. Yeah, other than that, we'll just kind of go through this, and we have a fucking million images that
yeah.
we inserted into.
I have unintentionally opened the floodgates to this when I did this a few chapters back, and now we just keep inserting images into the doc to represent stuff that we're reminded of.
Yeah, so I'll have to actually put these in the video then.
So, bizarrely, the chapter starts by saying that Harry is in the dormitory when he's not, he's in the hospital wing.
Yeah, it says he woke up on Sunday morning to find the dormitory blazing with winter sunlight. But he's in, like, I guess that refers to just the room? I don't know, that's weird.
Yeah, it's confusing to me, because then they keep referring to things that obviously make it the hospital wing, so.
Yeah, and,
like, there was a brief here, I'm like, is he actually staying in his own bed? And then it's like, no, because, like, Colin comes, like, wanted to come see him in the previous chapter.
Right.
And, like, I don't think... I mean, maybe he could get into his room?
I don't think so. Why would Madame Pomfrey be in there?
Oh, that too, yeah.
Yeah, and so she brings him a bowl of porridge and then starts fiddling with his arm to, like, make sure everything feels right. And he's, like, eating the porridge with his other hand while she's doing this. It's like, Jesus, just couldn't have waited. But
nothing wrong with that.
Yeah. So... then, like, so, you know, I, like, here's the thing, it's, like, pretty much this entire book, like, even more so than the last book, I have been, you know, finding the smallest, stupidest shit to comment on, like, just nonstop, and I think this one might have been, like, the worst case of me doing that, but, there's a few points right at the beginning of this chapter where, Harry bumps into Percy coming out of the library, and he's, like, in very good spirits, and so now we have this, of course, this running gag of Percy just being, you know, constantly jacking off. Like, this is where we have gotten due to poor word choices. So now I'm thinking, like, he's doing it in the library and, like, getting off of just, you know, being in public places. And so then he's talking to Harry, says, like, they got 50 points for winning the game. And this is such a stupid minor thing, but it does make me wonder how that works. Like, I'm not sure if it's just the winner of the game gets 50 points no matter what, or if it's based off of the score. Because the winner of the Quidditch Cup is based off of who had the highest score between all the games. So, like, just winning all of them isn't good enough. You have to win by, like, a big enough margin. And so, you know, I was trying to think, like, how would that work? Because, like, you know, the snitch gives you 150. Couldn't only been 50 points. Like, it's probably scaled down or something. It doesn't matter. Also, the fact that you get 50 points from winning a game is, like, it seems a bit much. Like,
that is a lot.
Given most of the time, like, I mean, I don't know, it depends.
Yeah, there are only six of those games in a year, right? So
is it six? Is that how many you need for a round robin?
Yeah.
Okay. But, anyway, it's like, the point system is so fucked anyway, because, you know, in the first book, you're, like, losing 2 points, and it's a big deal, but in these, it's like, you know, you answer a single question, so it's like, great, 10 points to Gryffindor, so it's, like, I don't know. But anyway, then Percy says something like, I hope Ron isn't in a girl's toilet again, which, just due to the fact that he calls it that, makes it sound worse than being in the girl's bathroom. All I can think of is...
Well, I mean, like I mentioned last time, like, in England, we call the bathroom the toilet sometimes.
Yeah, I get that. It's just reading it and, like, thinking of it that way, it's like, oh, God. Like, you know, I immediately think of the fucking, like, the quagmire turning into a toilet thing. Just, yeah. So, Harry goes to find Ron and Hermione. They're in Moaning Myrtle's bathroom working on the potion. They're specifically
in the toilet bowl.
Yeah, they're actually in a stall, which I didn't realize. All three of them cram into this thing, but like
in the movie, they make it so they're just sitting on the floor.
Right.
To be fair, I don't know how they'd all fit in the stall unless it's like pretty big.
Yeah, so here's where we're going to get into some stupid shit that I didn't know was a thing until I've seen people bitch about it online. So first of all, like, so Harry comes into the room and he's like, he wants them to know, like, oh, it's me, like, don't freak out, but they kind of freak out anyway and apparently drop something into the cauldron or something. And then Hermione looks at him through the keyhole. What keyhole is on a bathroom stall? Like, I'm confused by this.
Yeah, no.
Also, are you aware of the, like, the stereotype of American bathroom stalls?
Do you just mean how in, like, high school movies there's always, like, the assholes that stand on the toilets to peek over the, like...
No.
That's all I can think of.
No, I don't know if this is universal. It's probably one of those things where it's like, you know, according to Reddit, America's the only place that doesn't have bidets or whatever. It's just completely false. But there are noticeable gaps. Like, when you close the door it and, like, latch it or whatever, like, there's gaps between the door and, like, you know, the sides of it. So, like, you know, if you wanted to be an asshole, you could, like, go up to one and peek through it very easily. But it's just kind of like, you know, nobody does this. Like, why the hell would you?
Weird.
And so it's like, you know, when you're sitting on the toilet, you can see people on the other side. And I've seen lots of posts basically like, why the fuck can't you make your doors less shitty? Because apparently that's not the case in, like, any other place.
No, like, I don't use public toilets that often, like, even when I do go out. But they definitely close properly.
And so, yeah, as soon as they mention, you know, looking through this alleged keyhole, it just makes me think, like, you know, if this was an American stall, you'd just have no problem seeing through it anyway.
Yeah.
But,
all of the locks on toilet stalls here that I've seen are really simple. Like, they're just rotation thingies that basically just bar the door. Which, there's no reason that couldn't exist in a stall like this.
Yeah.
I don't think they need anything fancier. Even if it is locked with a fucking lock and key. Like
what key are you going to be using? Like, right. I don't know.
Anyway, so Hermione's got her special fire again, which we noted in the last book. They make a point of mentioning, like, she has, like, this specialty spell of, like, this blue fire that she can put in a fucking bottle, like, in Ocarina of Time.
Yeah.
And apparently the new 1992 edition is also waterproof.
Yeah, so they have this cauldron sitting on top of the toilet, and they have a fire inside the toilet, which is really freaking weird to me. But,
yeah.
All right. Like, I'm wondering, I guess the fire is just sitting, like, at first I thought it was inside a jar. But then they specifically went out of their way to say, like, this thing is waterproof, which I don't know how the fuck that works, but okay.
It's magic.
Yeah.
But yeah. So and actually, it says conjuring up portable waterproof fires was a specialty of Hermione's. So this isn't like a one-time thing. She's just good at this. But anyway.
Apparently. Yeah.
So Harry tries to tell them about what happened with Colin, and then Hermione's like, "Nah, we heard Professor McGonagall telling Professor Flitwick." So that to me basically just confirms, like, this is how info spreads around Hogwarts, is people just hear the teachers telling each other shit in broad daylight.
Yeah, I'm wondering what circumstances this happened in. Like, were they just standing outside the Great Hall talking about this as people filed in? Like,
So like, every time there was a thing in the previous book where it's like, you know, like in the last part where Dumbledore's like, it's top secret, and actually the whole school knows. Fucking McGonagall probably just blabbed to Flitwick about it. Maybe. In front of some students.
So yeah, they're discussing, like, while they're brewing the potion, you know, they're talking about, like, they're basically just talking about the monster of Slytherin, because, you know, they're basically like, well, you know, the chamber's been opened before, so that settles it. It must have been Lucius originally, and now it's Draco, because, you know, it's the only possible answer. But, okay. So they're like, you know, maybe it can make itself invisible or disguise itself. Because Ron just says, I want to know how come nobody's noticed it sneaking around the school. It's like, yeah, me too. How the fuck has the snake gone unnoticed? I mean, I guess to be fair, it hasn't been, because the people that are seeing it are getting petrified, but, like, nobody's seeing the back of it. Like, so, I don't know. There's, God, what the fuck is this image in response to?
You don't even know, you did it last night.
Yeah, I know. Hold on, I'm gonna have to keep track of timestamps here. But, so yeah, there's, it just mentions, yeah, everybody knows about Colin being attacked, and Ginny's, like, distraught over this. You know, the book isn't straight up saying this, but probably because she, you know, feels like something's weird is going on with her, which it is. It's Fred and George were covering themselves with fur or boils and jumping out at her from behind statues. For some reason.
Step two, cover yourself in boils.
And so, I'm, like, immediately I went to the fucking Ooga Booga Booga mask, but it also just reminded me of an episode of Futurama where, like, Fry and Bender get jobs at the, like, the cryogenic labs, and Bender just keeps putting on, like, masks and shit and scaring the people that are getting unfrozen, but I don't know.
Wasn't there a thing in Family Guy where there was, like, a really shitty running joke where Peter would just jump out from behind a tree and be like, hooga booga booga booga, and, like, it was, like, the stupidest attempt at scaring someone?
I don't remember this at all.
Because I don't remember the exact context, but I know that was, like, a running joke between me and my sister, and we've been doing that for, like, you know.
I will say, though, another thing it's reminding me of, now that I think about it, was, I would not call this a running gag, but it was, in the sense that they made the same joke, like, fucking 5 times in a row in one particular episode of Billy and Mandy, where they just kept flashing back to the same exact instance of, like, they're at a picnic, and then, like, some bear or something, like, braggle, fraggle, and, like, grabs Billy and runs off, and he's just like, hey, somebody help me, and just it showed the same scene like fucking 5 times, and it was hilarious.
But, it's like you, like, reloading a redead screen or something,
pretty much. So yeah, that happened.
So yeah, following that, I have a couple of notes here which are just direct quotes from the book. The first one is apoplectic. I don't know what this means, but the word was used.
Yeah, it was, fuck, where the hell was the, it was Percy was feeling that way. I have to figure out what the hell. They only stopped
when Percy, apoplectic with rage, told them he was going to write to Mrs. Weasley. Like,
was that when they kept jumping out at her,
yeah. Okay. So, like, what?
Sorry.
I mean, I could just look it up.
That little computer noise probably got caught by the recording, but what are you going to do?
No computer noise.
Don't worry about it. So yeah, there was that one, and then a roaring trade.
Yeah, that too.
That was in reference to, God, I'm having to scroll so fucking far to get back to this chapter.
Students are just selling each other random bullshit that they claim is, like, magical protective charms and shit.
Yeah, let me find what they were. Yeah, Neville buys a large, evil-smelling green onion, a pointed purple crystal, and a rotting newt tail. Like, these are allegedly protective devices, yeah.
And then they're like, dude, you're you're not muggle-born. What are you doing?
And he's just like, eh, you know, I suck at magic. That might still count. But, So yeah, then I have a, you know, insert image for this one as shown on screen now. It wasn't the one I was gonna go for originally. I was first thinking of a disgusting scene from Ren and Stimpy where I actually don't remember which one of them it was. It had a shit ton of like protective charms, and one of them was like a mouthful of pig intestines. And I don't know, but yeah, I couldn't find it.
So this is an extreme nitpick, but then there's a paragraph that starts
Oh God, this
in the
is
second.
the smallest fucking thing.
It stood out to me, okay? In the second week of December, Professor McGonagall came around as usual. There's no comma after December. It just says in the second week of December, Professor McG like it should be in the second week of December, Professor McGonagall came around.
Would that be an Oxford comma?
It would not, no. There's
Oh,
a
that's okay. That's when your
Oxford comma is I would
list of
like to
things,
thank
right?
my parents, Danny DeVito, and God or something. Like
Yeah, okay. I couldn't remember what that was, but right. Yeah, I don't know. It's like I look at this, if I was writing the sentence, I definitely would have put a comma there, but I'm like, it's whatever.
Then there's also the comma splice, but let's not get into that.
So, anyway, yeah, they're, you know, kind of discussing their plans. They still need more ingredients for the potion, and like Hermione needs to steal them from Snape's like private store. So, I like private
Which
store. He's running a
well,
fucking market out of it all. But no,
but no one can buy from it.
yes. So I noted that it's a pretty big step in her character to offer to be the
Yeah.
one to do the stealing, and I'm curious what would happen
And it
if she
makes
got
sense
caught.
because,
Because
yeah.
like, you know, other than being friends with a couple of troublemakers, she does have, you know, a reputation of being kind of a goody two shoes and teacher's pet and everything. It's like if she was caught stealing stuff, I have to imagine the teachers would probably immediately kind of piece out like, oh, you're doing this for Harry. Like, but and it's like, okay, what are these? What are these, like, what potions would these be used in? And kind of like immediately figure out what their plan is. And
Probably, yeah.
so, because in Goblet of Fire, like,
The same shit gets stolen from Snape stores again.
yeah, and then he's like, he actually blames them for it. He's like, you're brewing a Polyjuice potion, and I want to know why. And it isn't them in that case, but
Yeah.
so pufferfish eyes.
Yeah, God, what was this?
The sentence is Draco, yeah, Draco Malfoy, who was Snape's favorite student, kept flicking pufferfish eyes at Ron and Harry, who knew that if they retaliated, they would get detention faster than you could say unfair.
Okay. It makes more sense now that you've pointed out that he's literally like there are literally eyes of pufferfish on the table and he's flicking them at them with his finger. I interpreted flicking like not literally like you know, like flicking a glance at someone. I thought it was like Draco was giving he was like you know staring at them with the pufferfish like eyes. I'm like, what does that mean? Are his eyes bugging out?
Not yet. Somebody's will be soon, though.
Yeah.
But yeah, so I read that and I'm just like, you know, this is a good fucking use of animal parts. But either way, fairly stupid. So yes, they have to cause a distraction in class, and Harry has been tasked with this. So like, you know, he keeps kind of glancing over at Hermione, who's going to give him like the signal to do it. And there's a part where the book just directly states, like, it says, when Snape turned and walked off to bully Neville, it's like, I love how this is just, you know,
Yeah.
average, everyday behavior for him. So Harry, he ducks down.
And then the book turns into a video game stealth section where people can't see further than 3 feet in front of them.
Yeah, this part, like, before even rereading the chapter, I remembered this as being, like, incredibly stupid. Like, Harry, he like, ducks down, lights a firecracker by poking it with his wand, which I have to now question if that counts as his first use of magic. But, he lights this thing, and then he, like, it says he straightened up, which I originally read to mean like he actually stands up and does this, which he definitely doesn't, because that would make it even more obvious. But yeah,
Right.
he lights this thing, and then he, like, you know, just lobs it into Goyle's cauldron, So I have several questions here.
This had to have been an underarm throw if he's underneath his desk.
Well, it said he straightened up and took aim, but yeah, it's like, he does this with nobody noticing. I don't know what the classroom is shaped like, but imagining it from the movies, I think it's kind of like,
yeah,
it's kind of like circular, right? And they have like sort of like tiered steps.
I keep
imagining
it from the Chamber Secrets game, where the classroom is actually kind of long, but then they're only in the left half of it in like a square shape.
The way I always picture it is kind of like, it's just like tiered steps kind of like circling around the room, kind of like a band classroom, or at least the kind of ones that I've had. But
like a university, like lecture hall.
Yeah. So yeah, he throws this thing in, nobody notices this, nobody hears the thing go off, and he, you know, luckily manages to throw it into the cauldron in the first place. Like, if it had missed, you know, it still would have gone off and caused a little bit of a ruckus, but not enough of one for Hermione to, like, get in and get the shit she needed, probably. So, yeah, this very easily could have gone wrong. But, you know, it works.
I like to imagine he stared at the camera and went, like, shh.
Oh, my God. So, yeah, they're making a swelling potion, and this thing explodes everywhere and hits a bunch of people, and they get kind of, like, fucked up from it. So, we've got more good images here.
Yes. Yeah, I inserted these. For Malfoy, we've got Squidward sad at his big-ass nose, and for Goyle, we've got a Tom and Jerry reaction shot.
Which, that one was like fucked up, because I'm like, it says, you know, Malfoy has like a nose the size of a small melon, and it's like, okay, whatever. But it says Goyle blundered around, his hands over his eyes, which had expanded to the size of a dinner plate. Like, at first I thought it was his hands got that big, but it's like, no, I think that is referring to his eyes. Like, that sounds fucking horrifying. Like, yeah. How are they, like, are they just, like, you know, expanding out of his eye sockets? Like,
they have to be.
Like, goddamn. So, yeah, this massive thing happens, and Snape's just like, if I ever find out who did this, I'm gonna fucking kill you. And he, like, stares right at Harry, and Harry's just like, I don't know. Like,
but Harry doesn't say anything, but he just tries his best to look innocent.
Right.
So, like, as I was reading this, I'm like, boy, it sure is convenient that the potion they were making was, like, a good distraction. And I'm like, eh. No matter what the potion they made was, it probably wouldn't have, like, they probably still could have done a distraction, so whatever.
Yeah,
so,
I would have done something.
This is terrible, but it mentions that, like, you know, Hermione, you know, sneaks off during the commotion, and then she comes back with her robes bulging with the stolen ingredients. It just says her robes are bulging. And, like, I know what it means, but my mind went to other places first, including just, you know, the potion got on her and, like, her aunt's.
I'm curious what places it went. Like,
yeah. Oh, what, my mind?
Yes.
Like, oh, I mean the audience can imagine.
I mean, maybe I'm gendering this too much. Like, I'm like, okay, what would be bulging other than, like, if she suddenly just had giant boobs for no reason?
No, but, like, I was imagining, like, if you think about the stolen ingredients, I'm like, where did she fucking put them? And I'm like, I don't know.
Yeah. Alright. So, yeah, that whole scene concludes, and then, basically they see a bunch of people kind of crowding around. Like, there's a notice saying, like, they're starting a dueling club, and everyone's like, oh, man, we need to do this. Yeah, it's gonna be so cool. It's like, it might be handy, and someone says, like, why do you think Slytherin's monster can duel? So, again, image.
I mean, Harry does fight it with a sword eventually.
This is true.
I saw a post once that was like, Harry did not take the wizard class. He is a fucking rogue. He sneaks around. He kills shit with a sword. Like, he has some spells because he's like an arcane trickster type or something, but no, his main class is rogue.
His signature spell is a utility, so.
Yeah, he disarms people and, like, engages in a lot of subterfuge.
So, the book wastes no time. It immediately, goes to the dueling club. I had noticed that it was a little different than I was expecting, but did you want to...
They mentioned that it's, like, up against a wall or something. In the movie and the game, there's sort of, like, a long table that people stand on. Or, in the movie, there's a table people stand on. In the game, it's kind of like a weird pit with, like, a fucking tennis net in the middle.
The fuck? Why?
I don't know. Because you actually get to do the dueling club as, like, a mini game. So they have this weird setup where you can move around within, like, your half of the field.
I see.
And, yeah.
To me, I just, I didn't realize that this thing was happening at night, and they've got, like, the ceiling enchanted with the night sky and everything, and it kind of sets a different mood than I was imagining. And so, yeah, they're like, I wonder who's gonna teach the class, and Hermione mentions, like, Flitwick was a dueling champion, which I forgot that that was ever actually mentioned in the books ever. Like, I had seen people mention that online, but I always thought it was just, like, a weird bit of, like, expanded universe information. It also says that, like, almost the entire school is here, but for the remainder of this section of the chapter, like, every time a character is mentioned, with one possible exception, it's always somebody from Harry's year. Which is fine, because...
It should be Harry taking notice of the people he knows.
Yeah, and that's fine, but I think it especially stands out when they have, Harry and Draco are doing, like, the fight, like, up on the stage for everyone to watch, because I feel like if they wanted... I mean, yeah, Snape's an asshole, but originally Lockhart was going to have it be, like, Neville and Justin, I think. Sure. And it's just... I feel like... in a real scenario, they would have had the older students be the ones demonstrating, but...
Probably.
Also, Lockhart's robes are plum.
Yes.
This is not important, but we must point it out every time that he has weirdly colored robes.
So then, before dueling, you must bow to your opponent. So there's this nice contrast where Lockhart does this super fancy flourish. He's, like, waving his arms around and bows very deeply, and Snape basically just nods at him.
Yeah. It gets their characterization pretty clearly.
Yeah, it's nothing new. Like, we know these characters pretty well by this point, but it just reinforces that.
Yeah. So, I got kind of annoyed by this part, and it's for a stupid reason, and it's because in the movies they have this tendency to make, like,
every spell,
especially in this scene, it's like, yeah, you shoot a jet of color at them and then they just kind of go flying back. Like, I seem to remember in this particular scene in the movie they do a bunch of spells and it's pretty much just, I'll shove you back. Yeah, well, I'll shove you back, but they're all, like, different spells. It's like, get some fucking creativity in here. But and of course in the later movies, every single duel is Priori Incantatum with, like, the fucking DBZ laser. But
even when it's not, it's just, like, blasting random people. It's just like, pew, you were hit with my magic TM.
Yeah. Magic missile.
It's like, what did the magic do? It's just magic missile. I've seen a lot of people point out that the wizard, like, fights in Harry Potter are, like, really lame and a lot of missed potential for interesting magical interactions, and I kind of agree.
Right. But, yeah, so...
Case in point, the Deathly Hallows video games for consoles were literally just third-person shooters, but with, wands instead of guns.
So the reason I point this out is because this is where Harry sees Expelliarmus, and, it changes his life forever. and it's... The way it's described is, Snape and Lockhart are up on the stage, and Snape does the spell. It hits Lockhart, and he goes flying back violently and hits the wall. And I'm like, the fuck? Is that what it's supposed to do? Like, because
Expelli is, like, to remove or, yeah, expel, like, and then armus is in the armaments, what they're...
I have to keep an eye out for that, like, every time they do it after this point, because I swear it changes at some point to where it's, like... I imagine it's just, like, a string is pulling the wand out of your hand.
Yeah.
Like, I can especially... Like, I'm thinking of a moment in the Prisoner of Azkaban movie where they're, like, all kind of clustering in the shrieking shack and everyone's getting disarmed and shit. And I swear there's a part where that happens where it's just like, yoink, and it kind of just flies out. So, I don't know, that just kind of irritated me. But this lesson sucks ass. Because
it really does.
This happens, like, you know, Lockhart gets blasted by the thing, he loses his wand. All right. And he's like, oh, well, it was a pretty good idea to show him that one. I could have stopped it, but I didn't. All right, everyone pair off. It's like, what? we've shown one spell, not shown, like, you know, instructions on how to use it. Just, you saw it used once, and now let's immediately just, you know, pair off and do this. And nobody fucking does it. Like, everybody just does their own thing.
Including Milton Bulstrode just...
wrestling.
Engaging in some muggle dueling with a...
Yes.
With a mine. He just fucking jumps on her and starts beating the shit out of her.
Okay, so... I am about to go on one of the stupidest tangents here. There's a part where, you know, they're supposed to pair off and Ron and Harry are gonna do it, but then Snape is just like, time to break up the dream team, I think. I hope I didn't learn this from Potterless. I probably did, because I know that he's obsessed with basketball. But, dream team is actually specifically a term that came into creation to refer to the 1992 Chicago Bulls. And the only reason I point that out is because I've actually seen, like, stupid...
Oh, well, it's, like, anachronistic?
No, it's not. It's actually correct. But the problem is, like, I hate to make this reference because I fucking hate when people talk about this in general, but, you know, the Mr. Enter fucking turning red 9/11 thing. I've actually seen people mention, like, oh man, the most unrealistic thing about Harry Potter is that, you know, nobody's talking about the, like, amazing, like, Chicago Bulls team. Like, which, you know, it's in America.
We're in England.
So I don't know why that would matter, but, like, I guess, like, you know, if you're into sports, it was a big deal, because that's generally considered, like, one of the best teams that's, like, ever been assembled. I don't know. But, like, you know, somebody made that comment, but they were wrong, because it was mentioned here. Stephen Snape knows about it.
God.
So, that's my bit.
Excellent. All right. So, speaking of Millicent Bulstrode, because I just mentioned her a minute or two ago... I was like, I didn't pay attention to her description here, I guess. There's a lot of stuff in these books I don't remember from my reading them as a kid. I imagined her as being, like, an alpha bitch, you know, like the pretty popular girl of Slytherin. I don't know if there is one. If not her, I guess the implication is just not.
I think
sucks, so they're all, like, ugly and
the only Slytherin girls that I can think of that ever get mentioned by name are her, Pansy Parkinson, and,
Maybe I was thinking of Pansy Parkinson. Is she supposed
is
to
it...
be, like...
Well, she's pug-faced. Ugh. And then there's... I don't remember if it's Astoria Greengrass or Daphne Greengrass. I think there's both. I don't remember anything about either of them. I know Draco ends up marrying one of them, but... yeah, it's like they never show up in the books at all. So yeah, I think this is getting back to the whole...
good-looking Slytherins.
Yeah.
Like, Harry thinks all the bad people are ugly thing. Yeah.
Yeah, which I always thought was just, like, I don't know why people get upset over that, but, eh. yeah, I don't remember if we ever see anything else of Millicent Bulstrode after this, but, like, to me, like, you said you pictured her a certain way. I always pictured her as just being the female version of Bruce Bogtrotter from the Matilda movie.
I've not seen that movie in, like, probably 20 years, and I'm 23 years old.
So. He's the really fat kid that has to eat the entire chocolate cake in front of this whole school.
Oh, I see, yeah.
It, the only reason I picture that is because, first of all, her name. It sounds very Roald Dahl-esque, and does. Also just, like, it keeps describing her as being large, so that was just kind of what my mind went to. I don't know if she's supposed to be fat, though. I think she's just big. So, I don't know.
Big bone. So, then we get something that confused me greatly, because it mentions Rictus Sempra and calls it a tickling charm. No, the fuck it isn't. I don't care if this is the first mention of it in the books, which are the official source. They're fucking wrong. Richter Semper is not a fucking tickling charm. Richter Semper is the thing that's supposed to be, like, the thing that fucking pushes you back. At least in the video games, Richter Semper is the thing that is, like, your generic hit stuff spell.
I see. I don't remember, like, you know, I played the game the one time that we did the stream of it, and I played it, like, one time very briefly. I think it was, like, a demo when I was a kid, so I know basically nothing about the games. The only thing I remember from that was just Flipendo!
There were a few spells that were kind of generic-ish. There was, like, Flipendo, which just flipped stuff, but then it was also used for, like, hitting switches, which I don't know why that counts as flipping. Because it would literally, like, push them into the wall. Richter Semper was introduced in Chamber of Secrets, the Chamber of Secrets game, and it was, like, a generic hit stuff. But then in, what was it, Prisoner of Azkaban, at least in the PC game, they changed it to Depulso, became the push stuff spell. But then Richter Semper was still there. It just became, like, a damaging spell for boss fights and stuff.
Good.
So, like, you would push panels with the... Flipendo was completely gone. You would push panels with Depulso, and then you would damage stuff with Richter Semper.
Good shit. But yeah, this is Harry's first use of a spell in the entire series. Snape forces Harry and Draco to kind of pair off, and they're like, the way it's described is extremely dramatic. It's like, you know, this is supposed to just be a practice thing, but, like, you know, they're out for blood immediately. And it says, like, you know, bow to your opponents, and both of them do it without, like, they won't take their eyes off each other. And,
that must just mean they're in love.
Oh, yeah. So Draco hits him with some unspecified spell, and Harry retaliates with Richter Semper. I love how that's his, like, his first idea.
Yeah.
But, apparently it's pretty effective, because then it says, like, you know, Harry had to fight the urge to attack Malfoy again while he was, like, doubled over on the ground from, like, the tickling, like, the laughing or whatever.
Yeah.
Which, I do like that they kind of mention that, because it's, you know, showing that he's, you know, even if he hates Malfoy, he's not going to be a, like, dick about it. Yeah, like, just, I love how, you know, they have this idea, okay, let's take all of these kids and just have them fight each other, you know, I don't know how many students we have in this room, but, you know, several hundred, everybody just go at it and fucking, like, mass chaos, like, nobody fucking does the disarming spell, and even if they did, it's still apparently flinging people back, smashing into walls and shit, like... There was no chance of this ever being a good idea, and we can't even blame Lockhart for it, because Snape approved of it. So, like...
Right.
So, yeah, it's just... Everything just fucking immediately goes to shit. And you have a bit here.
Yeah, I'm trying to find the context. Here we go. So during the fight between Malfoy and Harry, Malfoy gets up and uses Tarantallegro, which forces Harry to start dancing.
Yeah, it's like, I don't remember where it is in any of the books, but it says something about a frenzied tap dance. Which I think...
I assume that's what this is.
I think that made its way into the portrait of what appeared to be a large pile of ash. but it was definitely in the original books as well.
But what? Following this, Snape casts Finite Incantatum, which it seems to just act like dispel magic in D&D, because Harry stops dancing, Malfoy stops laughing, and it just stops. And, I think there's another spell that gets disabled as well, because it's like... Yeah, some shit was famous. But anyway, like, I find it interesting that there is just a, like, stop the magic spell.
I'm curious how...
You like, research this, right?
I'm curious how you're picturing this. When you say, with the dispel magic from D&D, is that the type of thing where you just apply it to an area and then, like... all magic ceases, or, like, no new magic can be done, or how does that work?
I assume it's probably slightly different between versions, but the way I'm familiar with it, and this might not even be 5e, this might just be like the way I've rolled with it, because I've DM'd a lot, but I don't actually read much of the source books. I kind of just, I know how the game roughly works, and if it comes to stuff like this, I often just kind of make it up or interpret it the way that makes sense to me. But I think of it as just like, you know, if there's a magical effect on something, you just end that. If there's multiple on one thing, I don't know if it would affect multiple. It wouldn't be like an area. So if there's like two people standing next to each other, I would think you could only dispel the magic on one of them.
Okay, because that's basically how I pictured this is working. Because I saw that you had that note on it, and
I didn't mean that specifically, but just like the idea of like you turn off some other magic.
Right. I was a little surprised that you had a note asking about it, because in my mind, this was like an extremely, you know, bread and butter spell, but I looked it up and it isn't. And I don't know why I thought that it was, because as far as I can tell, the only other time this spell is actually mentioned in the entire book series is Hermione brings it up once in Deathly Hallows when they're in the Ministry. She suggests it as like the thing to stop the rain that is like happening in some office. Because yeah, to me, I was like, yeah, you know, there's a magic canceling thing. While looking it up, I then found out that there's also just Finite, which I think is just the same spell but shorter. Because that one's used a few times. It's used, I think. Actually, now that I think about it, I think the Frenzied Tap Dance happened to Neville during the battle in the Department of Mysteries. It gets used on him to stop that. Tonks uses it on Harry when he is petrified on the train in the sixth book. It's used a couple more times. Here, it seems like Snape is using it as like an AoE in the hall and just stopping everything, which I don't know if that, like, I'm not sure if that's a thing that you can do, but he did it, so, we'll just chalk that up to Snape being, you know, the strongest wizard in the series, according to the fanbase. Anyway, there's actually one thing I forgot to even put a note of here. It says that, you know, after all this chaos ends, it says, Ron is holding up an ashen-faced Seamus, apologizing for whatever his broken wand had done. So two things here. First of all, good thing Harry didn't end up with Ron, otherwise he would have gotten blown up. Also,
blown up.
I wonder if this line is what inspired the running gag in the movies of Seamus always blowing shit up. Because
didn't that happen in the first book as well?
Did it? I don't remember. Cause, like,
I feel like I remember a discussion where you were annoyed that it actually was in the book or something.
Oh, maybe.
So maybe it happens like a couple times in the books, but then they just make it like super common in the movies or something.
Yeah, it's like that's his like that's his character trait in the movies, is he's just the kid who blows shit up. And Flawbones and what?
Have you not heard that?
Oh my god. Do we need an explanation here?
I basically just summarized it there. I've seen people say that it's like a little oof or something that Seamus's gimmick is like accidentally blowing stuff up because he is Irish and there's like, you know, still some, how do you say, like fallout in some places, but as a result of like the whole shit with Ireland in like, I don't actually remember when it was, I want to say like the 80s or 90s or something.
I know nothing about this, so.
Yeah, it's a part of like the history of the British Isles.
I see.
But there was like a lot of car bombings like associated with the IRA, which were like an Irish terrorist group.
I see. Just get Reddit on it; they'll find out who did it. So, anyway, obscure character time. As we're talking about, like, all this crap going on after, you know, everybody was fighting or whatever, Lockhart is just kind of naming off a few people randomly, like, as he's helping people out. He says, "Careful there, Miss Fawcett. Pinch it hard. It'll stop bleeding in a second." I had to look up who this was because I couldn't. I didn't recognize the name offhand. She is mentioned here and three times in Goblet of Fire, and then that's it. And in the instances she's mentioned in that book, once is just offhandedly saying, like, her family was not able to get tickets to the World Cup, and apparently she lives near where, like, Ron is, so, like, otherwise, you know, there would have been, like, you know, probably traveling as a group. she was one of the people to grow a beard from Dumbledore's age line surrounding the goblet, and she got caught, like, making out with her date at the Yule Ball, like, when Snape is going around making people not have fun. So
I remember that. I remember there's a shot in the movie where just before Snape meets with Hagrid and Madame Maxime, there's like a couple that he like points his wand at and they like separate. Is that supposed to be her?
I think it might be. But yeah, we don't actually know what her first name is. It apparently starts with an S because in the like charity Quidditch Through the Ages book, there's like a thing in the front showing like the students that had recently checked out the book, and S. Fawcett is on there. This is all we get of this character.
Clearly it's Sarah Fawcett.
Yes.
Shit,
what were the names of the other alleged girls in Harry's year in Gryffindor that were there the whole time but you never see? It was like Alice Runcorn, I think, and then Sarah something, or I think it was
Sarah. It was Sally Smith.
Yeah. Apparently these characters exist, but they are never mentioned a single time anywhere. I don't know.
But yeah, so then we get, my wand is a little overexcited.
Oh my god.
Which, there is absolutely no fucking way this isn't an innuendo, and Snape even smirks while Lockhart says it. So.
Well, yeah, it's like, it's a pretty great scene, because, anyway, like, the context here is, you know, everybody gets done fighting, and it's like, alright, we should probably teach you how to block unfriendly spells. It's like, yeah, we probably should have done that. You're right. So, like, but they don't do another demonstration. They're just like, oh, we'll have the students do it.
Yeah.
And so, you know, Malfoy and Harry are picked, and Lockhart's like, here, I'll show you how to do it. And he does, like, this stupid little twirl with his wand and drops it. And he's like, ooh, got a little overexcited. Like, and that's the demonstration. That's all we get.
Am I remembering this wrong? I could have sworn that, like, Snape, like, leans over and, like, whispers something into Malfoy's ear before he uses Serpent's Sortier.
Yeah, he does.
Why am I not still... Where the fuck is it?
It's right after the overexcited bit.
Oh, there we go. Yeah, so, like, I didn't actually write a note about this, but did he tell him to cast Serpent Sortier?
Probably.
Well, why does he get away with that?
I mean, what? Because Snape's a dick, I don't know, like...
But anyway...
I mean, he probably knew that, like, you know, whatever happens here, like, either he can kill the snake before it hurts anybody, or, like, you know, they can...
I just wonder what was his motivation in the first place? Because all class, like, yeah, let's teach him the defensive spell against Expelliarmus. And Snape's like, eh, I'm gonna summon a snake. I'm going to get him off.
I don't know if this is supposed to be defensive against Expelliarmus specifically. I feel like this maybe is supposed to be Protego, but we never see because he fucking drops his wand. But also, we get the iconic "Scared? You wish," which I've seen listed as like good bedroom talk.
Oh god, all of the dreary shit today. Okay.
Not even for them specifically, like,
okay.
I've seen posts mentioning that just that type of shit. I don't know, I'm not getting any more into
that. There's nothing more homoerotic than a bit of magical fighting. But yeah, then we get the pretty memorable scene for this book where, you know, the snake comes out, Harry's like, no, go away, and then everyone's like, what?
Harry, yeah, the way it was described was really weird, because, like, the snake comes out, what?
I did that too, I said snake instead of Snape, and now you said Snape instead of snake.
Good. Yeah, the snake comes out, Lockhart, like, blasts it into the air ineffectively, and then for some reason it just immediately goes after Justin. Like, I don't know. But, like, so it does, this happens, and then it says, like, we'll Harry doesn't know why he suddenly started doing this, but, you know, just with no conscious effort, he started running towards it, and it's like, cut it out! And then the snake immediately looks at him, and he's just like, all right, I saved it. Everybody's safe now. Like, it's, the way it's worded is really weird.
Yeah.
He looks up at Justin, grinning, like, yep,
I saved it.
But, yeah, and then everybody freaks out, and this whole thing pisses me off, but...
Yeah, this part of the chapter, like, is really... you said it's really contrived, it just... It upsets me. And so, it didn't even need to be this way, exactly. They could have made it less infuriating.
They could have, like, if it had been written differently, it could have been made very unclear what Harry was doing.
Yeah.
Whereas here, I think it's basically just everybody wanted to vilify him, and this was a good reason
right.
to.
Yeah.
Because, like, the way it's worded, you know, the snake is heading towards Justin anyway. Harry runs up, says something... And then it stops.
And then the snake leaves. Yeah. So that's, like, really obvious. That...
The movie honestly kind of did it better, where he, like, he says the thing a few times and the snake doesn't really seem to respond much.
Mm-hmm.
Because everybody keeps using the phrase, like, oh, he was egging the snake on. Which is a weird phrase, but, I mean, it's, I guess it's correct. But, I don't know why that would be everyone's immediate, like... conclusion there. It's like what yeah. why would he be doing this? Just
it,
like,
it doesn't make any sense that Harry would just be like, now is a great time to reveal that I'm a dark wizard and ask this thing to kill my classmate right in front of everyone.
Yeah, it's like, you know, it's focusing on somebody's like, do it
exactly.
like what the fuck.
It's like, it always reminds me of an Ace Attorney where it's like, yes, we caught the defendant holding the gun when their fingerprints are all over it, and then they shouted, I'm going to kill you and my name is blah blah blah, and it's like, see, this is irrefutable proof. And I think there's only one time in the series where the lawyer you're playing as goes, that makes no sense, why would they do that, this is evidence that they're being framed.
God.
And most of the time you just have to, like, you know, go around and prove that the evidence itself is wrong or something, instead of just being like, this is obviously a setup. But anyway.
So, yeah, there's the whole bit with, like, you know, this happens, everybody's, like, staring at Harry, like, what the fuck did you just do? Because, you know, he was hissing at this thing. And, like, even Snape, it mentioned, what was Snape's... Yeah, he gives him a shrewd and calculating look. Like, everybody's just like, huh. Didn't expect that. And Ron's like, okay, let's go. He, like, fucking drags him away from everything before, like, you know, all the shit-slinging can occur. They talk about it. You know, Harry explains that he had talked to the snake once before. And I love this line here. Just, a boa constrictor told you it had never seen Brazil, Ron repeated faintly. Like, just, he's, like, completely incredulous. He's like, yeah, so? Also, again, very glad Ron is the one having this discussion instead of Hermione being the one to know fucking everything. She does know about it here because she's the one that says that, like, Parseltongue was Salazar Slytherin's, like, kind of like
still,
she can speak
to the kind of thing you would read in a book.
Yeah.
But Ron has absorbed the culture. He knows this stuff, like, you know, implicitly.
Right. It makes more sense. So yeah, they kind of argue about it and they're just like, you know, this looks really bad, and Harry's like, well, who gives a shit? Like, I saved him, like, whatever. But they are right because everybody is extremely illogical about this. So, I don't know if there's much else to say about that scene.
But I think it's still a little weird that he can just speak the language without knowing it. That is, like, it almost feels like a contrivance just to make it so that it was, like, a sort of mystery. You know?
Yeah, I mean, it's...
It depends.
I never really questioned it that much, but...
Like, because you might think, oh, maybe Pasopong is, like, you know, a magical language. It's not just a regular language. Like, maybe there's a magical component to it, which is why you can speak to snakes, and why, like, you know, Harry did other magic without realizing it as a kid. But then that gets thrown out the window, because Ron just fucking, like, mimics it in the seventh book, which I have no problem with, but it does, you know, it does go against that theory of, like, it's a magical thing. Because, no, it's yeah. just...
Like,
I don't know. It is still magic, but it's also a language. So it's like, it's a regular language that magic can just cause you to know implicitly. It's fucking weird.
It is a little bit weird. They mention, so like, I have a bunch of notes here. I don't know how long this part's going to go on for, but basically, you know, they have that whole conversation. Harry's confused, like, how can I speak this without knowing it? And then it like kind of cuts to late at night, he can't sleep, and he's, like, just angry over the whole thing. There's a part where it says he's, like, pummeling his pillow, which I think is just kind of hilarious. But it's, like, it also says, like, you know, if he very quietly tries to speak Parseltongue and it doesn't work, which, bad idea, doing that in the dorm, probably, even if he was doing it quietly, but still, And it says, like, maybe he basically comes to the conclusion, I can probably only do it when there's, like, a snake in front of me. And if I remember correctly, there's a part later where he opens the Chamber of Secrets by, like, looking at a carving of a snake on the, like, faucet, and, like, the way the light catches it makes it look like it's slithering, and so he can kind of, like, pretend it's real. We'll have to keep an eye out for that.
Yeah, I don't really remember.
But then, yeah, I think later on when he has to do it in other instances, he can just kind of bust it out, so I don't know. It's a little odd. I'm guessing that when Ron is able to, like, mimic it or whatever, it's probably just, you know, he got close enough, and I'm just imagining this thing is, like...
Shitty
connection. Voice recognition. Yeah, like... So, you know, Voldemort's...
X-Bax! It's not working!
The Locket Horcrux, you know, it's specifically... It's not enchanted where you have to have... You know, you have to be able to speak Parseltongue. It's just... It's coded to listen for that wavelength. So,
I thought it's enough. Not the Locket. I thought he opens the Chamber of Secrets.
Oh, right, okay. Yeah, you're right. Because, yeah, Harry opens the Locket, Ron hears him do this, and then Ron opens the Chamber of Secrets.
Yeah, Ron opens the Chamber of Secrets to go grab the Basilisk Fang.
That's right. Anyway, so there's a whole bit here where they're like, you know, everyone's going to think you're the heir of Slytherin. He's like, well, I'm not. Well, you can't prove that. There's a thing that's like, Harry didn't know anything about his father's family, so, you know, maybe there was something going on. And I had this very brief, stupid moment where I'm just like, why does it have to be his father's family? Like, why couldn't it have been from his mom's side? I'm like, oh, right, she's Muggle-born. Okay, never mind. I do actually really like how they set up the thing with the boa constrictor and the sorting hat saying, like, you could be great in Slytherin in the first book, and then they brought it back here. I think this is, like, the first good instance of,
like, foreshadowing or
payoff.
Like, stuff up early. Yeah, payoff. Yeah. I think the books are generally pretty good about that.
Yeah. So I have so many stupid things here. It's they're supposed to have herbology the next day, and it gets canceled because it was snowing really hard, and Professor Sprout wants to put socks and scarves on all the mandrakes. And wouldn't trust anybody else to do it. Like, it's supposed to be a silly throwaway line. And it's not, it's probably supposed to be dumb. But, like, what the fuck? Like, like, they're in dirt pots. And even if it would get cold, like, are socks and scarves really what you want to go for? I don't know, like, whatever. So Harry's just kind of wandering around the school aimlessly because the class is canceled. There's a bit where, like, you know, Ron and Hermione are playing chess, and Hermione says, like, and I quote, "For goodness sake, if you want to talk to him so bad, just go find him." Like, I love the idea of Harry just brooding while they're playing this game. If I could only tell him what's going on. Like, she's like, shut the fuck up, just go find him. So he's wandering around. He wanders past a transfiguration class where he hears McGonagall shouting about somebody turning their friend into a badger, apparently. Which I just thought was a funny throwaway line, and I didn't realize there was payoff for it later.
Yes.
So we'll get to that at the end of the chapter. He goes to the library, he sees a bunch of the Hufflepuffs, and he's, like, kind of listening in on them talking shit about him, and he's doing this while hiding in the invisibility section, which is just kind of hilarious. Like, basically, they're just kind of being assholes. It's, the person who seems to be spreading the most
bullshit. They have the shittiest logic here ever, because they're just like, well, he can do this, you know, basically irrelevant thing that some bad people can do. So, yeah, it's him. He did it. There's no other possibility. To be fair, Harry's logic has been just as shit, where he's like, Malfoy's kind of a scumbag.
Yeah, pretty much.
But, like...
I didn't even think of it that way. Yeah, it's honestly... It's pretty much the same thing. Except in this case, Malfoy is actually a piece of shit. But,
yeah.
But yeah, it's mostly Ernie McMillan who's the one kind of doing the shit-flinging. And the rest of the kids are kind of listening and just like, oh, you really think so? He's like, yeah, definitely. And I don't think we've really seen anything of Ernie yet. He's never a major character. But, like, I seem to remember him always being described as being really pompous. And so... I guess it kind of fits. Mm. But yeah, the setup for this is pretty good, though, because, you know, they're talking about all this shit, and it's like, but Harry's so nice, why would he do this? And he's just like, he's actually probably a dark wizard. Remember, you know, who couldn't even kill him? He was trying to get rid of his competition. And Harry just can't stand listening to this anymore, and so he just...
This is just like the conspiracy theorist rules. It's just like, think about it. Doesn't that make sense? It's like, I mean, you know, that's a possibility, but the fact that you can come up with a possibility doesn't make it true.
But yeah, Harry, like, he can't stand listening to this bullshit any longer, and so he, like, dramatically walks out from behind the bookshelf and clears his throat, and they're like, oh! And it's so good. He's just like, I'm looking for Justin, do you know where he is? It's like, Harry...
Leave that up.
Like, come on.
Say, like, I want to talk to Justin. Like, can you guys take me to him? Like,
yeah, I'll like,
talk to you guys about it, like, you know... Like, even if they're being stupid and dumb about it, it's only going to make things worse to leave out details. Like, just, you know, make yourself as little of a threat as possible if you're going to do something.
But yeah, they immediately start calling him out, and they're like, oh, we knew it! And Ernie's, like, trying to be brave. He's just like, we're not going to let you. Like, we know what you've done. And he's like, shut the fuck up. And they're like, ever since Justin let slip that he was Muggle-born, they're like, he's like, I can prove my heritage. And Harry's like, I don't give a fuck. But he doesn't mention, like, you know, I'm friends with Hermione, like, and she's Muggle-born, and that doesn't matter. And it's like, again, does this count as the I have a black friend excuse?
I don't think it's legitimate. Like, I don't think so, because people usually say that doesn't count for stuff like, you know, being casually insensitive. I think it's a pretty good argument for not being, like, a fucking KKK member, you know?
Yeah, it's like, you're not gonna, you know, be trying to off, be, like, Muggle-borns if you are best friends with one.
Yeah, exactly.
Again, you could make the, oh, they're one of the good ones argument, but whatever. But yeah, Harry doesn't think to mention this, because...
Well, he does not make exceptions.
I don't know. And so, you know, there's a bit of a pissing match, and he gets sick of their shit and leaves. There's a bit where it says, like, he's blundering up the corridor in a fury. And so that just immediately made me think of this image from the Potter musical. Yes. I have to insert that one.
I have not seen it, but...
I haven't either, but I'm well acquainted with many memes from it, because they were very frequently mentioned in the comments of Mark Reed's Harry Potter.
So I'm trying to remember what the context is of this next note that I wrote.
It's...
here we go. Harry starts talking to Hagrid. And Hagrid says,
Something's been killing the roosters.
And he's like, it's either foxes or a blood-sucking bugbear.
I've got a tangent to go on about that one, but
yeah,
I'll wait.
He's like, yeah, it's either foxes or blood-sucking bugbear. Here's a rule of fiction. If there's a mystery and somebody tells you, well, it's either A or B, the answer is C, none of the above.
Every or, time. You know, it could be he's either in Paris or much more likely still in the abandoned automotive lab. Like...
That's not a mystery, though. That was, like, a temporary plot beat.
Bugbear, then. I'm pretty sure these are never mentioned again. I had to look this thing up because I only know bugbears from, like, D&D, and I've...
Yeah.
Even then, I've only ever heard of them. I still don't know what the fuck they are.
Like, they're, like, big, hairy goblinoids.
So I checked, and they're never mentioned again. It like the Harry Potter like wiki article basically says like they must live on the Hogwarts grounds, or otherwise like Hagrid wouldn't have suspected this. But otherwise, you never learn anything about them. But it also says that like apparently boggart is typically like a synonym for bugbear.
Huh.
But like. A boggart is a totally different thing in this canon.
Yeah, Rowling plays fast and loose with the...
I went on a little bit of a rabbit hole with that and learned that a boggart is considered a non-being, and it's one of only three things that are in that classification, the other ones being dementors and poltergeists, and they're all just... They're things that get created through emotion.
Yeah, they're sort of like magical... Like, yeah. I can't even say beings, but they're just, like, the results of magical effects.
Right. I barely fucking remember anything of the first Fantastic Beasts movie, and I've not seen the other two, but I feel like the Obscurial would also probably qualify, but it wasn't mentioned, so I don't know.
I don't know shit about that. I've never seen any of them.
They're generally considered not good. I would probably want to still watch them again at some point. Like, watch the first one again and see the second one.
Oh, they're not even done anyway.
I've heard they're kind of shit. There were a lot of people saying that they actually, like, walked out of the theater.
I've heard the first one is, like, meh, the second one is bad, and the third one is garbage. Basically.
Yeah. But yeah, that's all I've got on that thing.
Yeah, okay.
Spiders.
Yeah, so I it took me until this read to notice that, like, these are supposed to be a misdirect. This is the second or third time. Well, I guess it must be the second. I can't remember. But anyway, we've seen multiple times, like, at the scene of, you know, the petrification. Yeah,
basically,
like,
Harry's... After Harry goes stomping off, he finds, you know, Justin fucking dead on the ground, and nearly headless Nick is, like, he's turned black and smoky, I think they described it, like...
Dude's like really fucking weird.
Yeah.
I don't think I'd realized before that, like, you're supposed to think, like, oh, maybe the spiders are responsible.
But... Yeah, it is kind of weird. I kind of overlooked it also, because it's just, you know, Harry finds the scene of the attack, and it just says, like, where is it? Yeah, he's looking around wildly, and he saw a line of spiders scuttling as fast as they could away from the bodies, which is weird to me, because...
I actually don't know why they're there.
Yeah, like...
Because, like, it's mentioned that the again, spoilers here, Hagrid has a pet acromantula, which is basically a giant spider, and they are, like, the ultimate enemy of the basilisk. But this doesn't go anywhere. I don't think Aragog ever interacts with the basilisk in any way.
They don't. Like, when you eventually learn what the basilisk is, like, one of the things describing it is just, oh, spiders fear, like, flee from it. It's like, okay.
So I guess just all of the random tiny, like, spiders just scattered across the nearby area just all were like, oh no, and like went into a neat orderly line
running away from Justin's body. Specifically,
they are British spiders, to be fair.
Oh my god.
So it's in their blood. But
so yeah, that was a thing. It just kind of mentions this line of spiders running away from the body. I don't know why the fuck they were there in the first place.
So, speaking of contrivance and this whole stupid situation of people suspecting Harry, did we really need to have it be that Harry's like, you know, not only does everyone arbitrarily think it's him just because he speaks parcel tongue, and then he talks to the Hufflepuffs, he's like, I'm looking for Justin. They're like, you're admitting your crime to us. And then he also has to just be there alone.
Yeah, like, crime. Immediately, like, afterwards. It looks so bad.
If they went with, like, a movie version of the first scene, right, and then Harry didn't interact with the Hufflepuffs here, or, you know, he was more friendly with them and they were willing to hear him out, and then they go to try to find Justin, and all together they find Justin dead, or petrified, that would have worked fine. I would believe that they would suspect him from that. And it would still feel like, you know, Harry wasn't stupid, and the story didn't need to tie itself into knots to make Harry look suspicious.
Why would they have suspected him if he was, like, moving in a group with them, and then they found the body?
Just if, you know, because they were worried about Justin in the first place, and thought that Harry might go after him.
But, yeah, I don't know. Point is,
Harry didn't even need to be there. Like, they can just discover... They can just be like, we're not going to help you find Justin. Harry leaves.
Yeah, he could have gone back to his dorm.
Hears about Justin, and they're like, you did it. Like,
they yeah,
didn't need to fucking put him there.
It's a little annoying. There's a line in the sixth movie.
It's like the story where, is framing him.
Yeah, pretty much. But there's a line in the sixth movie with McGonagall. It's just like, why is it every time something happens, it's always you three? It's like, right. Yeah, pretty much. Like, they're the only ones that matter. So,
you know, there's a scream. Professor McGonagall comes running with a class.
Yeah, so... Well, what happens is Peeves shows up, and he's just being a general piece of shit for no reason, like he always is. And then he sees he sees Justin and nearly headless Nick, which, again, this ghost has been stunned somehow. And, you know, he starts screaming, like, attack, attack, and everybody rushes out. It says, McGonagall came running, followed by her own class, one of whom still had black and white striped hair. Now, when I was taking the notes on this chapter, I read the whole chapter once, and then I went through it again more slowly while taking notes. It wasn't until the second one where I'm like, God damn it was the Badger Kid. Like, I didn't, because I read that, and I'm like, the fuck, what do you mean? And I just kind of didn't question it.
Yeah.
I love the payoff on that random blink and you miss it line. But yeah, so they all show up, and the group of Hufflepuffs is there, and Ernie immediately points a finger at Harry and screams. He's like, you've been caught!
Caught in the act!
Yeah, it's just like, you know, this fucking dramatic thing, and it just... I have a stupid clip I need to insert here, because that was the first thing I thought of. But, yeah, and McGonagall immediately shuts that down. She's like, shut the fuck up, no. like, calm down.
I want to guess what your next note means. It says, Professor Sinistro of the Astronomy Department. I'm guessing your complaint is, there's no fucking Astronomy Department. She's the only...
I mean, pretty... Is it a she? I never remember. I think we see this character, like, twice. Yeah, it just says, Justin's carried up to the hospital wing by Professor Flitwick and Professor Sinister of the Astronomy Department. They could have just said, like, you know...
Astronomy Professor.
Right. Like, there is no department.
Yeah, Aurora Sinistra. She's a witch.
Okay. So yeah, that happens. And then it just says, nobody knew what to do for nearly headless Nick. So eventually McGonagall conjures a large fan out of thin air, which she gave to Ernie with instructions to waft him up the stairs. This is hilarious to me for several reasons, because I love that she just makes Ernie do it. Like, what the fuck? Yeah. She just...
Probably because he was being an asshole, I guess.
Yeah, Like, we can't have a teacher take care of this or, like, do it herself. It's like, you, random kid, I don't like you, you do it. Also, I've always pictured this as she's just conjuring, like, just, you know, an electric stand-up fan. Mm-hmm. Which is not the case, because they can't use, like, appliances. So it's probably just like a big paper fan or something, which is almost funnier. But honestly, both of them are kind of funny. So, you know, Harry's just like, I didn't do anything. And she's like, well, she says this is out of my hands, which makes it sound more like dramatic than it is, I think. Like,
yeah, it's a little bit cheap.
I feel like she doesn't actually think it was him, but this makes it sound like does. So,
I don't think it does. I think that I interpret like so. Obviously, we know what she means is like, you know, let's just go talk to Dumbledore. The way it reads to me as like imagining myself as a first time reader is that she's like, I believe you, Harry, but this is not up to me. Like,
to me, I always read it as just like, basically, she's just like, I can't protect you because you keep doing this. Like, I don't know, but
I don't think that's what out of my hands means, though. Out of my hands is like, you know, I don't have the authority here,
I guess. So yeah, she takes him up to Dumbledore's office, and it's the end of the chapter, and I have like two more stupid things to mention for no reason. One of which is just, we have the appearance of the Griffin door, which was mentioned in the Let's Watch of the movie with Martin, like, that I did way back in the day. Because it says, like, they go up the spiral staircase to the office door, and it says, yeah, it has a brass knocker in the shape of a griffin. It's totally a pun. And then the last sentence is just, he now knew where he was being taken. This must be where Dumbledore lived. And I don't know why I find that funny, but I do. Like, because it's not wrong, but, like, it's Dumbledore's office. Like, this leads into his office, and then I assume there's, like, a door in the back that's, like, his bedroom or something. So, it's just, I like to, it's funny to me because, like, the way I wrote it in the notes is, it makes me think of the teachers live in school thing that maybe kids sometimes maybe believe maybe.
I believed it as a kid. Because I remember when I was like 4 or something, I heard mention of like somebody seeing my like teacher out of school or something. Well, no, I think I was on a road somewhere with my mom in the car, and she was like, oh, that's where your teacher lives, by the way. And I'm like, no, she lives at school.
Yeah, it's one of those things where just as a kid, you don't recognize that people you interact with have lives outside of what you see them doing. So yeah,
exactly.
It's I can buy that. Like, it's like, you know, they're a teacher, they don't do other stuff. But yeah, it's like, I specifically actually read a book as a kid where like the whole class basically believed that their teacher like slept in the classroom, and there was this whole thing about like, well, how does she cook? And it's like, well, we have this toy like kitchen thing over here, like, you know, she can make it work or something. And then the teacher had to kind of like show them, I think she like took them all to the like to her house to basically be like, nope, I have a house, like this is like, I don't know, it was a pointless little book, but it just reminded me of that, and it was kind of funny.
Yep.
And I guess that's it. Kind of just ending on a random side note there. Yeah. Do you have comments?
Let me get them up.
You never remember.
You're right. I can't argue with you. You're right. So one comment mentions that, like, in some, you know, accounts of basilisk mythos from real life, it is said that, like, one of the ways to kill it is by having it look into its own eyes with a mirror. So, theoretically, Colin's lens, maybe, or definitely at least Hermione's thing, and possibly the water reflection, like, should have killed it, but...
Isn't that how Medusa died in Greek mythology?
Yeah, Perseus had the, what do I call him? Percy? I don't even read fucking that book series. Perseus, the Greek mythological hero, had like a shiny shield. He had the mirror shield for Zelda.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, obviously, you know, the basilisk doesn't have to be 100% how it is in you know, how the real basilisk works. It doesn't have to be like that. Let's see. Yeah, just more questioning of, like, house elf logistics. Like, can they not do laundry? Like, you know...
Yeah, like... There's a bit in one of the later books where Hermione starts knitting hats and leaving them around, and, like, the house elves eventually stop cleaning the Gryffindor Tower because, like, they're worried they're going to accidentally pick one up. Yeah. So, I guess they can't do laundry. They cannot ever... Like, that's really fucking weird to me. Because, like, especially in the case... If that's the case, like... If a wizard, like, leaving an article of clothing somewhere and then the house elf picking it up later is enough to break the enchantment, I'm surprised Dobby was never able to manage to do that.
Yeah, you'd have to like keep all your clothes under fucking lock and key. Like, you're childproofing it.
So, yeah, I'm going to consider that one a minor plot hole.
Yeah, the house elf stuff, that kind of doesn't make sense to an extent anyway. I'd be went into great detail about before.
Yeah.
And then I don't remember exactly what we were talking about, like, when this was mentioned, but, you know, regarding timeouts in soccer versus basketball, because I think you said they don't have
soccer doesn't have them
in basketball. somebody mentioned that, like, one score doesn't matter as much in basketball, so if something like that gets interrupted, then it doesn't matter as much. I guess that kind of makes sense, but I don't know,
maybe. Not my field.
They have some more to say here, but I don't really have anything to respond to, so.
Okay.
I suppose that's that.
Yep.
Join us next time for the Polyjuice Potion.
Which has a very ugly bit of chapter art.
I vaguely remember it.
Let me winks.